Hello. This is the, in case you're in the wrong place, hopefully you're not, it's the webinar on refrigeration efficiency and optimization. My name is John Farker. I'm Senior Renewables Consultant with SAC Consulting. I'll be presenting today. Okay, today, this evening, what we're going to cover. Basics of refrigeration, just very quickly. I'm sure most of you know the most about it, the types and the mechanics. And then the monitoring, which I think is the crucial thing. But it's relatively straightforward for refrigeration. And then we go on to the myriad of things to do with optimization. We won't so much be talking about the actual storage, we're more talking about the refrigeration systems themselves. But it's a fairly high level overview of the sorts of things you need to be looking out for. And then covering a bit about maintenance, but it's fairly straightforward stuff. Okay, purposes. So we are mostly just cooling stuff, and that's normally above zero, so it's not freezing it. So we're talking about you do not need to run at sub-zero temperatures, which is helps you if possible, because it means you don't have defrosting issues on heat exchangers. The other one, but less so in agriculture, but sometimes uses freezing, and that's always obviously got to be very low temperature, and that always has to take into account defrost and freezing of plant and heat exchangers. And then the other main use of refrigeration is to dehumidify things by condensing water out of the air. So I'm not really going to be covering dehumidification or anything like that, but it's the same plant inside of it, so lots of things apply. Main types, these are just the main, there's lots of types of refrigeration plant you can use, more or less commonly used. The one that we all know is the mechanical compression cycle. That's what's in pretty much 90%, 95% of what refrigeration equipment. It's high capacity and medium efficiency. When I'm saying efficiency here, I'm really talking about electrical efficiency, because that's what we're really concerned with. And then evaporative cooling, that's just relies on absorbing heat from the air, which cools it to evaporate water. This is found in agriculture quite a lot for processed potato storage. So they could also call it adiabatic cooling, but it's evaporative cooling, it's the same thing. It's quite low capacity. You can't go down to low temperatures, but it's very high electrical efficiency. It's just the efficiency of the fan. So so we took efficiency, we took COP, which is coefficient of performance. So as I said, mechanical compression cycles are 2 to 3, we can in agriculture, when it's quite warm, we can often get 4, COPs of 4. And then we have absorption or adsorption cycles. They're very similar. One is based on liquid and one's based on a solid, but they are becoming more common because you can use waste heat as the energy that drives it. They are high capacity and they have very high electrical efficiency. They're not energy efficient at all. You have to put back 1.5 to 2 units of heat into it to get 1 unit of cooling. But if it's true waste heat, then it is incredibly efficient from an electrical point of view. And they are becoming quite a few plants that you are looking at them, especially running from biomass boilers or steam plants and things like that. Okay. So the kind of basic mechanics of refrigeration. So all refrigeration, whatever system it uses, basically it relies on temperature and energy differences. So heat will move from high energy to low energy. Or high warm places to cold places. The ones we're going to be talking about is the compression cycle. And it transfers heat by compressing a refrigerant into a high pressure hot gas, and then allowing it to expand into a low pressure cold gas, and it has to absorb heat to do so. The refrigerants is just any substance that can boil at a wide range of temperatures that suit your system needs when you increase or reduce pressure. And like all liquids, water same, they absorb heat when they boil, and they release it when they condense back. So this is the my rubbish drawing of it. So this is the bit that we're interested in generally. That's the cold bit, so that's the evaporator. In comes out of something called an expansion valve, your liquid, cold liquid event, refrigerant, and it absorbs heat through the evaporator, which is usually a coil, but in the back of a fridge, it's just a wire thing. It can be a plate. And as it absorbs it, it boils to a cool gas. So it absorbs energy as it boils. And this is usually happening, depending on the usage, somewhere between minus 30 and plus 10 or 12, depending on what you're using, whether it's a fridge or a freezer and the type of refrigerant. So the cool gas, it's at low pressure, goes into a compressor, and that compresses it. So this side of the system, where it's the blue side, the cold side, is usually below ambient pressure. And then you compress it across the compressor and you get high pressure hot gas. So this is the high pressure side. It goes into the condenser. That's the usually it sits outside the refrigeration plant, or it's the, in the case of a fridge, it's the system of tubing on the back of the fridge, and it gets rid of the heat, because the refrigerant gas can be at anywhere between 40 degrees and 120 degrees, again depending on usage. So it will get rid of the heat, and as it does so, it condenses back to a liquid. So it's still high pressure, and then it goes through your expansion valve, which as it expands, it loses temperature and drops. So it's gone from a high pressure liquid to a low pressure liquid. It absorbs, it becomes very cold, and it will start to absorb heat. So that's the cycle. Where have I gone? Oh dear, shouldn't use the mouse. Okay, one important component we're going to talk about today, which is does apply to most systems in agriculture, because it's got dealing with wet products, then you're keeping them quite low, but not all of them, is defrost. So if your evaporator temperature, which is this bit over here, if that is running regularly below zero and the air temperatures are low enough, so typically when you're anywhere from about 3-4 degrees below your storage temperature, you're likely to have your refrigerant below zero, at minus 2 or so, and the air is cold enough to cool, and it will condense water, which is fine, but then it will also freeze, and so the ice forms on the coil, which ice is actually a very good insulator. So it reduces their performance, and also it can, if it's a blown air system, it will reduce the airflow. So you need to defrost it. Most systems at these sorts of temperatures, or a lot, I would say, less common, it is not as common anymore. It's what is called off cycle, passive off cycle. All you do, you don't even actually plan it, because the way refrigeration systems work, once they're up to capacity, they switch off the compressor. And if it's doing that regularly enough, it will just, the ice won't form, or it will melt, or it can be timed. So on a timer, you can just plan to switch off 4 times for half an hour a day, but it's, you don't know what it will do. But obviously when you switch it off, it will increase the temperature of your store, which you then have to get back down to temperature. So it is, any defrost cycle will probably lose you energy. The active ones, which again speed up, is you switch off the refrigeration, but you keep the fan going, if your evaporator is a fan, to blow the warm air out over it. But this is only for stores that are above freezing point. So it's quicker, but it uses fan energy, but you might use less compressor energy to then cool the store back down. This is probably the active off cycle, the most common one in potato stores, I would say. And then anything, or quite actually, so is the electric elements. found in the coil. So this, what it does is when the ice builds up or it's programmed in, it switches on electric heater and it's defrosted in a matter of 10, 15, 20 minutes, very quick. The passive cycles can take up to an hour to defrost it. They use up a lot of electricity, these cycles, and it can be 10 to 20% of your overall electricity usage, depending on the humidity and the conditions and how often the doors open and things like that. So defrost is a big energy user if you have electric heaters. The electric elements on, I would say, poor ones run behind the coil, which means a lot of the heat that they produce just goes straight away and it doesn't even melt the ice. So you waste a lot of heat. Good ones have it in the middle. Or alternatively, the coil is sloped backwards, so the heat goes up through the ice. Not so common in agriculture, I would say, but in commercial plants is very common, is that hot gas. And it has a special circuit to take the hot gas from the outlet of the compressor and puts it straight into the evaporator. And that will heat the ice from the inside. So it's very efficient because you're using a third or less electricity to produce that hot refrigerant. And so it's far more efficient, hot gas cycles. So this is a rubbish drawing of it. So basically all it is the hot gas has a separate set of valves and it is piped down straight into the evaporator on a scheduled time. So it'll just run with solenoid valves. So it just bypasses this section and goes straight into there. The big problem you've got is you run out of heat because there's nothing to form heat. Because in the full cycle, you get heat from over here and put it over there. The only heat is what you've got stored in the gas. So there might, if it's a low volume system, it might not be enough. In which case, the other one that's used is what we call a reverse cycle. And you literally run everything backwards on a circuit, but you do need two expansion valves. And those are, they're found in quite large systems that will need a lot of defrosting. Monitoring. So the main thing, if you want to make your store efficient, is knowing what's going on now or what's going on in all the different components. Because you might think, oh, I don't use any defrost, but you might find that you actually do. You don't know how long it's running for, if it switches off. So obviously store temperature, and preferably at multiple points throughout the store. So you do still get stores with just a little probe stack hanging from the roof in the middle. Doesn't really, with unless you've got a very, very good air circulation system, it's probably not going to be very good, because there'll be a huge variation across your store. And it could be 3 or 4 degrees. Multiple probes throughout the store. And especially any spots, dead spots from a point of view, or warm spots. The air on and off your chill coil. This can tell you if it's blocking sometimes, or if there's a problem with a fan, if the temperature difference across it changes. So that's quite useful. Air movement. This is a kind of a check more than monitoring, but it's really useful. Smoke pellets that, if you've got a chimney or something, you'll often get the chimney sweep will test your flue with a little smoke bomb. Those are really useful for telling where airflow is. You can release them whilst the ventilation system's on and see where the air flows. And it can be really useful. And it's good for checking for dead spots. Humidity is quite useful in cold stores. If they suffer badly from condensation, or if your potatoes or Swedes or anything, or any of your product is getting quite a lot of condensation, it's really good to know how close you are to the 100% humidity or saturation point. So that can be, and it's a very easy, simple thing to monitor. Set points. These ones are hard to monitor because most control systems don't record their set points at different times. So this is usually a notepad and writing it down. But there can be, on some of these systems, there can be 5 or 6 different set points, and it's unlikely you're going to remember them all when you're trying to set things up. So writing the set points down up is quite key. And this should be quite out of the order, the power and energy. It can be as simple as taking your electricity meter readings for the whole site, or if you've got them separately. It's not so useful Preferably, I would certainly, because electricity meters are pennies. They're tens to a good one, but a cheap one is going to be 60, £70. Monitor everything separately. So you're on your fans, on your compressors, your defrost system, your condenser, as much as you can, so you know how each one is performing and when you're saving energy. It might be even worth getting something called a data logger, and then that just records it live every 5 minutes or whatever it is, and gives you a lot of information. Their data loggers used to be 2, 3, 4,000 pounds. They now can get them for £400 or £500, so it can be a very useful thing. And lots of them are portable, so you can use them on other systems. Airflow rates. There's many ways of doing it, and there's many points you can do it, but depending on your air distribution system, people get hung up on the absolute accuracy. Airflow is a very, very hard thing to measure. Very hard thing to measure. I think the absolute accuracy doesn't really matter. It's got to be consistent. So as you change your fan settings or your box settings or your air distribution, it shows that up. But it can be useful. I wouldn't be going for a very expensive accurate one because that could be 10, £20,000. Don't need to worry about that. But it's some simple kind of pitot tubes or impeller systems can tell you a lot. Optimization. So overall, there are major things that affect the efficiency of the actual refrigeration system. We're not talking the cold store. This is just the refrigeration plant at the moment, is the evaporating temperature. And that's pretty much determined to a degree, measured by the temperature you want in your store. The rule of thumb we use in refrigeration is often 6 degrees below your target temperature is what your evaporator needs to run at. So if you want 2 degrees in there, it's got to run at -4. I have a slightly different take on this. There's ways you can get big benefits by not running that much lower, but that's the rule of thumb that people use. And then the condensing temperature, and it's normally sized and determined by the outside temperature at the worst case. So for a refrigeration plant that's running in the summer, which isn't all potato stores, but if it's running in the middle of summer, you'll be sizing it for 25 degree ambient. Or in some places even hotter. So it's got to be able to get rid of the heat. So that means your condenser's got to be above 30, 25. And again, 6 degrees or more, maybe even 10 degrees more, is the minimum. But the efficiency is generally is the difference between those two temperatures, broadly. So the warmer you can have the evaporated temperature and the cooler you can have the condensing temperature, the more efficient your plant will be. The type of refrigerant used, that does play. It's not so much the type, it's the suitability for your application. Is it close to being as good a refrigerant at the temperatures you're wanting it to work at for most of the time? We have less choice now from refrigerants with regulations coming in on refrigerants. I'm not going to talk about refrigerants because I don't. It's a science and an art into itself, which your system often determines. You can do a choice of one or two types of refrigerant. The new kind of plug-in low greenhouse gas one, or you might even be using some of the older ones. But that does determine your efficiency. And then the type of equipment used. We can probably, well, if we're buying a new system, this is where you're going to get your efficiency gains. And the system controls. By themselves, system controls don't do much. They've got to be set up right. Lots of people abandon automated controls and just do it manually because some of them are so complex and they're not set up. They actually mean it doesn't fundamentally do its job. And then the correct maintenance of the system. So if we talk wider than the refrigeration system, the biggest energy loss with any cold store is leakage. That can be through the fabric of the building, but most of it's through the door. The door stays open because you've got to get in and out of it, and depending what is happening in your store, whether you're grading that day, whether the forklift driver can be bothered to close it after them, or if you've got curtains. But air leakage can be responsible up to 50% of your energy losses. But also, depending on the system they get quite leaky. They can leak through the gaps and joints in composite panels or in the eaves is a very particular place where you lose a lot of energy. People concentrate on the ridge, but the eaves is often where you a lot of air gets out. And the important thing is also pretty standard nowadays on newer stores, but lots of old stores don't have a personnel door. So you've got to open that massive door to get in and out of it, even if you just want to go and check something on the refrigeration plant. So you lose a lot of energy when you open that main door. There are systems, and I think they were things like, if you've got a very high power circulation system, especially what they call overhead throw systems, which put the cold in air over the potato boxes or Swedes or whatever it is, they really do move air very powerfully. And if you open the door at that time, a lot of more cold air will go out if the fans are switched on than if they're switched off. So sometimes you have a switch which switches off the fans when you open the door. They're usually on a delay timer, so actually they will come back on if it stays open for more than half an hour or something like that. Plastic strip curtains. I'd say probably when everyone builds their potato stalls, lots and lots of people install these. Quite often they're permanently hung up because they get ripped off or it's very hard to drive through them. The benefits of if you can get them to work are immense. They really do save a lot of energy, but they are, I can understand operators struggling to work with them. But if you do manage to seal it and you do keep it sealed, I mean, there's also logistical management and making sure your first part of your work, you just work at one store at a time so you can leave one sealed for months at a time. But if you do manage to seal it very well, beware that potatoes will produce a lot of CO2 when they metabolize, when they're respiring. So it can build up in potato or any store, any product store. So beware of that. It's not big, it just generally dissipates quite quickly, but it's something to be aware of if you really nail the air leakage. It's one thing that is quite easy to do nowadays is get your store tested, if you've got a personnel door anyway. And you can find the leakage. They can test it and they'll soon know where the leakage is. And you can even sometimes do a smoke test, depending if they've got product in there or not, and you can actually see where the physical leaks are. They're well worth doing to see if your store is up to scratch. Insulation. Actually, this is what, when people talk about the building and the culture itself, this is what people think of first of all. However, it's generally secondary to air leakage from the fabric to your energy losses in most situations. The spray-on type, actually, it's kind of gauze got slammed, but as a whole thing, it seems to be one of the best performing ones because it seals the building as well. It fills in all the cracks and it stops air leakage. However, you do often have to, it does degrade over time. So you do have to sometimes do a spray over the top or to augment it. Modern stores are all composite panel and they should all have PIR foam cores. And 100 mil is the standard now, and that's good. But the care needs to be taken over the jointing system because that's where you will lose your air. And it should be pressure tested. If you're getting someone to build it, they need to pressure test it before they hand over to make sure it is well sealed. So insulation, this is it's also worth getting. You can is thermal imaging of your store. That's shows kind of, these are composite panels, but you can see again in the eaves lots of places where it leaks. So you can actually now buy fairly cheap £100-200 thermal imaging cameras that go on your phone. So I've got one, they're pretty good, but quite useful to spot where the cold or the heat is leaking in, cold is leaking out or heat is leaking in. Right, so air distribution type, this is within the cold stores. So we're talking about that is, so in lots of bulk stores, especially overhead throw ones, fans can actually account for up to half of the energy use in that system. It depends on when you're storing potatoes and things like that, but, and in many cases, they actually over-circulate the air to try and even out the temperatures within the store. Because some people think that those overhead things, they actually kind of drive air and suck it through boxes. It doesn't really. How it works is it just cools the air around the boxes and then the air moves by thermal differences. So the warm air around the potatoes rises and heat transfer from the cold surrounding air. So it doesn't have great airflow through the boxes, and therefore it's not very good for drying and things like that and curing for those overhead throw systems. But if you can get uniform airflow throughout the store, that's key. And you can often reduce your fan usage because of it. So the basic starting point, which is very rarely done, is a divider curtain from the overhead throw tubes to stop it just dropping straight down and into the air in that right below it. Because you get a lot of direct air circulation that way, and you lose a lot of your air throw going to the back. A simple plastic sheeting, do it over the tubes, the ducting, can make a big difference. And then there's really advanced systems, which are these divider curtains with, so you put sheeting on top of every other box. I've got some photos in a minute to explain it. And that can create, with a clever plenum at the front, can create a lateral airflow through the boxes. So this is a picture of the divider curtain. So it just stops the air dropping back down, this cold air dropping straight back down in front of the and into the air inlet, which is at the bottom. That can make a big difference. So there's a lot of work has been done this by Suttonbridge Crop Storage Research Centre. They've done a lot of work on cold storage and airflows through some various projects. There's a lot of information there for you. And this is again one of them, and it's a lateral, creates lateral throw. So there's a bigger gap here, and you put plastic on it. And at the front here, there's a plenum there, so the air can't go back through the end of this row into the air inlet. It has to go down through here, through the box, and then it's sucked out through this way. So it's just, there's a clever plenum at this end that creates flow through the boxes. And you get automated systems now that put in new stores, which put this plastic down for you and lift it up. So you don't have to have people walking along the boxes bear in mind that right there is a big gap. So quite dangerous. So this creates very good flow, but it's a forced flow through it. It's not just relying on cold air up here and then heat transfer. It will be pushing. So A, brings down the temperature more quickly, but also you need a lot less airflow and therefore a lot less fans. So this can save yourself a lot of it and can be retrofitted quite easily. As I say, quite easily, apart from the danger of putting this on the top. But the end at this end is just plastic sheeting or wooden boarding to create the right airflow. Okay, compressor. Not talking a lot about compressors, but ones we're going to talk about are scroll compressors and reciprocating compressors, because they're the most likely you're going to find in agricultural type refrigeration systems. Freezers are often reciprocating and refrigeration is scroll, but not always. Older systems will be reciprocating. Don't need to know how they work, but as a rule, if you've got to pick one, pick a scroll. They are more efficient than reciprocating, but they are harder to maintain or a bit throw away if they break. There's less maintenance you can do. They're more likely to be hermetically sealed. People talk a lot about variable speed compressors. They're not commonly found in agricultural cold stores, I would say. Seeing them a bit more because they're quite expensive still, but that will change, I think. I think if you 5-10 years when you buy one, they'll all have variable speed dryer compressors on them. However, if your defrost system relies on an off cycle, i.e. just relies on the fact that on-off compressors just switch on for a bit, let's say quarter an hour, and then they switch off quarter an hour, the variable speed ones will be on for a lot longer. Therefore, they won't be an off cycle to defrost, so you might have to have active defrosting. So for me, where I have a bit of doubts, very little work, or I've never found any work on the difference between the extra energy used for an active defrost cycle that would be needed with it over the energy savings of a variable speed. So I'm not 100% set on variable speed, but it can be if there's very variable loads, but it's depends on each system. Defrost. This is something that's quite easy to do a lot about. It's, if you've got active defrosting, either hot gas or electrical, it's going to be using quite a lot of your power. So And even if you're not using power actually, to minimize it, you don't have to switch the store off for as often. So for active off cycle stuff, you still would rather it didn't, because every time you switch it off, the store warms up and you've got to use extra energy to bring it back down again. This is where I say that the evaporator temperature wouldn't necessarily be at 6 degrees below your target. If you start, it's got to be designed around this from the start. If you're aiming for 2 degrees, you're going to struggle. But if you're aiming for 4 degrees, you might have the option of running your evaporator above freezing. It's got to be a bit bigger. You should be the same fan, right? But it's you might just have to run a bit longer. It can be system design point of view. But if you have to have an active one, choose hot gas over resistive electrical all day long. Uses about less than a third, about a quarter of the electricity. But it's very difficult to retrofit. It's quite easy to retrofit electrical elements, but you can do it, but it's not likely to be done or cost effective. So it's an option when you buy it, but hot gas is way more efficient, but not very common on an agricultural system, I would say. So the defrost termination. So quite commonly, systems have defrost. It's just on a timer, 4, 5, 6 times a day. It starts up, and some of them are just planned. They just do quarter an hour every time, whether it needs it or not. That's less common now. Normally, there's something called a defrost termination sensor. So it'll start 6 times a day. There's a temperature probe on the actual coil, and that if it's in buried in ice, it won't change above freezing. Can't do it. It will always stay as freezing. Once it goes above freezing, then now it's clear of ice, then it switches back to refrigeration mode. Placement, they get knocked off. Normally the place where ice builds up is where the refrigerant comes into the evaporator, but not always, because it depends on the airflow. But yeah, that's a basic way, but you will always be starting the defrost cycle, whether you need it or not, because it takes a while. There's a late lag before it allows that to kick in. The newer systems, and the ones I like, are the demand systems. So it will, it sensors to detect ice formation on the coil, and it only switches to defrost mode when it needs it. Some of them, there's various sensors of different costs. Some of them measure the thickness of the ice with a measuring device, which can be ultrasonic or infrared or laser. Laser are quite expensive, but very accurate. Others just have a resistor or capacitor in the middle of the ice, and it changes as it gets covered in ice. Those may or may not be accurate, but they're pretty accurate enough for us. And these systems aren't that expensive, and you see them more and more. They will save, so people who've got them on in dry climate are saying it can go 2 days without running. Whereas if before now they've been doing 4 day frost cycles a day at certain times of year. So it can save a lot of power. And optimizing them. Commonly with refrigeration, we consider heat recovery. And if you have a heat use, brilliant. Often your refrigeration system's working hardest in the summer if you've got potatoes in there in the summer, and when you don't necessarily need heat. But if you've got a heat use, it's relatively cheap to do. There's two places or methods for doing heat recovery in most refrigeration systems. Is you've got the high grade heat, which is the heat between the compressor and the condenser. And they call it de-superheating. It just means bring it back down to the temperature where it's saturated. But because the gas that comes out of the compressor can be anything up to 100 degrees. That's usually the high grade heat. And then you could also actually condense the refrigerant, and then you get low grade heat, which is usually 30 or 40 degrees. So depending on what you're using, if it's mains cold water coming in, you can take the first bit out with the low grade heat on the condenser. And then heat at the second stage with the high grade heat and the near the compressor. So I had a slide prepared with it, especially. So the high grade heat is got from this area here, just as it comes out the compressor, and it can be usually it's generally done with a heat exchanger, water to heat water, but you can heat air again if you want. And there's a big air heater just here, so you can use that. Some people still do stick their refrigeration condensers in the grading shed and the warming area. There can be issues with that, but usually it increases humidity. But if you take the water there, so that's where it's going to be hottest, but you can also take the low grade. So imagine if you had cold water coming in here, mains cold water at 10 degrees, you can take the heat off the condenser, which is low grade, and then you can heat up further with the high grade water here. It's cheap to do. Some systems even come with a plate heat exchanger already fitted here, which is often never piped in. But you can take quite a lot. I mean, potentially, say if you've got a 100 kilowatt chiller, you've got up to 120 kilowatts of heat available. If you took it all away, it's unlikely to be you can do that, but that's what's available. So it's heat recovery is there. I mean, if you're really into heat recovery, you could always use a heat pump, because the cold side of that can be a fridge if you want, and that's the most efficient way of doing heat recovery, but quite expensive. So yes, but there are issues with heat recovery. If you do it too much and cool it too early, you can have, it sounds ideal, but refrigeration is quite complex, especially when it comes to lubrication and bringing the lubricating oil back to the compressor and to the collectors and receivers. It's got to be thought about. It's got to be designed into the system and allowed for. Just bolting one on as an afterthought can be problematical. Biggest problem is if you have too much, you can risk flooding your compressor. You can overcool it and get liquid back into the compressor. But it's there and it's available. It's just which that increases. But one thing you shouldn't ever do is, because when it's working at its most efficient, it has the least heat available. But you shouldn't ever compromise the efficiency of your refrigeration to get some waste heat, because use farm it so it doesn't stack up. So primarily, this has got to replace basically your condenser. Any more than that? Well, actually, no. It can do a bit more than the condenser, but not much. So last thing of kind of optimization is, sorry, it's got silly things in the way. Is voltage optimization. It's talked about a lot. Refrigeration systems, they have high peak electrical loads. And theoretically, on a big site, you could have up to 100 kilowatts, sometimes even 150 kilowatts of refrigeration system running, if they're all running. And then bring down, it might well be that. And they're running for quite long hours. So and most of that load is motors, running fans or compressors. The reason UK runs at a strange voltage, we run at 240. The rest of Europe runs at 220. And that's what most equipment is built and optimized for, is 220 volts. And the UK average is 242. And 415 for three phase, Europe is 400 for three phase. So this even relatively small difference, 10 to 20 volt difference, can lose you about 20 to 25% in power. So it's wasted. So it's less efficient. So you can get equipment that you can either correct it at the refrigeration plant or for your whole site. And it can, depending on your load, be worth doing it for the whole site. And all it does is bring it down to your target voltage, and it's usually settable, but anywhere from 218 to 222 is a common one that's set. That is often worth it. Certainly lots of the pack houses for fruit and things like that, they use this system, but its voltage optimization is definitely something worth considering. Especially in some areas, because I've been to sites where the actual mains voltage is near 250, which is kind of can be out of spec, but so it's worth doing. There is another aspect which has been talked about a lot is the power factor correction, which again on induction led like motors is important. However, newer motors and plant or even those will have power factor correction built into them. So it might not be, you need to assess your actual individual system you have, because it might already be corrected. You need to measure your own power factor. So, I mean, power factor is very, it's usually just a load of capacitors. It's not, but they are quite expensive to run it for a whole site. But voltage optimization is something that could save a lot of money. So these systems for a site could be, I mean, they can be expensive. They can be over 10, 20, depending on your load, £1,000, but it could save you £10,000 a year or something, depending on your loads. So it's definitely worth considering. Maintenance. I get there's not a lot to say this, but it is key. There's been quite a lot of studies done on maintenance refrigeration systems. And it's big. It's around a third. Poorly running systems average. There's worse than that. There's things that are running half as well, 50% addition, 100%, twice as much energy use. The main thing is getting your system regularly serviced. Every time there's poor oil in there, or there's not enough oil, there's not enough refrigerant, it's not working well, and it'll be using a lot more power. Again, if you're monitoring it, you might notice it. Depending if this you're comparing it with the same year or the same temperature, but something you might notice if you're monitoring the electricity usage. Cleaning the condenser and the evaporator coils, yeah, that's always stated. Quite a lot of systems have the evaporator coils hanging up on the top of a 12 meter shed. Not easy to clean them. So consider access if you can. If the evaporator is nice low level, definitely. But clean the fan as well. The blades of the fans, that makes a big difference. And the ducting, if you've got an overhead throw one, ducting and the louvers, they build up dust. That does increase the resistance to flow. And bearings. So many things are sealed bearings, but lots of refrigeration plant is really old, and they often have bearings that need maintenance. So it's worth checking. And if you've got a noisy system, it might be worth checking, not regularly, this is not a regular thing, but it's worth getting someone to check the balance of big fans, because that will, if some fans are 10, 12, £1,000, you can probably double their life if they're well balanced. Often what kills a fan is them going out of balance,